We're now going to move on from the space of geometric vectors, from which we learned new terminology, new concepts, new ideas, and we're now inspired to carry over those ideas to other linear spaces. So we're now going to talk about the spaces of polynomials and more general functions. So we'll consider two different spaces, and we'll also consider two different transformations. Our transformation will be the derivative operator and the second derivative operator. The derivative operator will be denoted by the letter D, and the second derivative will be quite appropriately denoted by D squared, because after all, the second derivative is the derivative applied to the derivative. So it's two successive applications of the derivative operator. And you're used to slightly different notation in calculus. You're used to the prime or d dx or something like that. But we're going to use something a little bit more consistent with linear algebra. And I just want to point out again that we've kind of forgotten this for some time, but we're now going to go back to celebrating the fact that linear algebra is applicable to all different sorts of objects. And even though the objects may be very different, many of the ideas are the same. The ideas may come from geometric vectors, but then they find applications in other spaces, including these spaces that are as different from geometric vectors as they can possibly be, spaces of expressions or functions. So keep that in mind as we're having this discussion. So you know exactly what the derivative operator does. Now we're going to interpret it as a transformation, and we're going to ask all of the same questions as we did before. Just another example of linear algebra being the science of applying similar ideas inspired by geometry to all different kinds of objects. The questions we'll be asking are these operators linear? If they're linear, what are the eigenvalues and what are the eigenvectors? We're thinking of functions as vectors. Very appropriate questions. One change in terminology: instead of calling them eigenvectors, we're going to call them eigenfunctions. But of course, it's the same thing, and maybe in the context of a linear algebra discussion, it would be good to stick to eigenvector. But that's just not the tradition. The tradition is to call them eigenfunctions, so we'll go along with that tradition. So just a couple examples. For example, d of x squared plus x equals, of course you know what it equals, it's the derivative of x squared plus x. See what a transformation is? It's a mapping. The input is a function, the output is another function. There's a rule for converting the input function to the output function, and it is up to me to give you that rule, and then once the rule is given, we'll analyze it together. So of course, the derivative of x squared plus x is 2x plus 1, and that's our first example. We should probably consider a couple more. Well, how about we'll go straight for the second derivative. So here we're doing four things at once. Two different linear, we don't know yet that they're linear. Two different transformations, two different spaces. So let's stick to polynomials here. X to the fourth minus 3x cubed. And we're now taking the second derivative, so this becomes 12x squared. 12x squared minus 18x. How about an example with still the second derivative, but a function that's not a polynomial? How about e to the 2x? And of course the answer is 4 times e to the 2x. Let's throw in a sign. The derivative squared, second derivative, of sine of 5x equals minus 25. Sine of 5x equals minus 25 sine of 5x. And this is just about all the calculus you need to know for this discussion. Just being able to find these elementary derivatives. So we're not going back to calculus. This is not a course in calculus. There won't be any calculus review, of course. We're just extracting the part of calculus that has the linear algebra framework, or that can be described in linear algebra terms, and talking about derivatives as operators or transformations, and we will now determine whether or not they're linear, is very much a subject in linear algebra. Okay, is this transformation linear, or are these transformations linear? And the answer is, of course they are. What you think of as some formulas in calculus, let me use the prime notation just so that it looks familiar. The derivative of the sum is, of course, the sum of the derivatives. You usually use this rule without giving it much thought, and you shouldn't. It's completely trivial. It's fundamental. Calculus wouldn't exist as we know it if this rule wasn't there. But from our point of view, it means that we're halfway to linearity. It means that the derivative operator, and of course the same would go for the second derivative, doesn't matter, is the sort of operator for which it doesn't matter whether you add the two vectors first and then transform the result, or whether you transform the individual vectors and then add together the results. So that's half of linearity. And the other half, of course, comes from this product rule. This is not product rule, this is multiplication by a scalar rule. And maybe it's a special set of the product rule, but it reads like this. And that's the second half of linearity. Works just as well for the second derivative. So we have both of these rules for first and second derivative. So yes, this transformation, these transformations are linear. And once we have a linear transformation, what's the next obvious question, natural question, important question is, what are the eigenvalues, and in this case, eigenfunctions of these two transformations? So let's try to answer these questions by trial and error. First, let's stick to the space of polynomials, and then we'll talk about functions in general. Can you think of a polynomial that becomes a whose derivative, and then second derivative, is a multiple of the original polynomial? Now your first thought may be, well, there's no such polynomial, because anything with x to the fourth will end up with something less than x to the fourth, right? Because the derivative knocks the power down. So how can the result be a multiple of the pre-image if it has a different power? That's a very correct way of reasoning. It typically won't be a multiple of what you started out with. But there is one little exception, and that's the constant function. The derivative of a constant function is zero. So this is constant the function, not constant the number. Let me draw a graph of this function. As any function, it has a graph, and if c equals 3, then maybe that's the graph. All right, this is f of x. Is it even in the shot? Barely. But you know what I mean. F of x equals 3. There you go, a function like that, a constant function. Its derivative is 0. And this is our second example of an eigenfunction, eigenvector you may think of it as, eigenfunction with the 0 corresponding eigenvalue. So an eigenvector cannot be 0. Uninteresting, inapplicable. But an eigenvalue may very much be zero, and here it's actually one of the more interesting eigenvalues, and here we're definitely seeing another example of the zero eigenvalue. That's it for the first derivative. Of course, for the second derivative, this eigenspace is a little bit richer, because you can take any linear function. Any linear function ends up being zero. So this eigenspace, corresponding to the eigenvalue 0, is two-dimensional. This was one-dimensional, and in the case of the second derivative, the eigenspace corresponding to the eigenvalue of 0 is richer. It is two-dimensional. The third derivative would have a three-dimensional eigenspace corresponding to the eigenvalue 0, and so forth. Very interesting. But that's it for polynomials. Polynomials don't have any other eigenfunctions, because that logic of the derivative knocking down the power is the correct logic. It's just that sometimes you end up with zero. That's the only exception. Fits well within that logic. Now, what if we now broaden our view to general functions? What are the eigenfunctions of the derivative and the second derivative transformations? When we allow all functions. Well, that makes, of course, these still apply because polynomials are still general functions, but there is now a richer space of eigenfunctions. And actually, there are some hints here. So for the first derivative, we can take e to any power, e to the, what would be a good power? Letter for the power. Let's call it, I don't want to use the letter a because a is used right here. Let's use p for power. E to the px, where p is a constant, is of course, by the celebrated derivative chain rule and the celebrated function in the differentiation table, p times e to the px. Now once again, very familiar from calculus, but now you have a much, don't want to compare, a very interesting linear algebra perspective. This identity states that e to the px, where p is any number, is an eigenfunction of the derivative operator with p being the corresponding eigenvalue. And as you can see, this is our first example where there are infinitely many eigenvalues. There are infinitely many eigenvalues. Any number is an eigenvalue of the derivative transformation, and we have infinitely many completely linearly independent eigenfunctions. Very interesting example, something that's very good to keep in mind. And that's actually it for the space of functions. All right, if you have studied differential equations, you can actually show rather easily that that's the only function there is. Let's talk about the second derivative. So whenever you apply a transformation twice, whatever was an eigenfunction or an eigenvector of the original transformation is still an eigenfunction or eigenvector of the repeated transformation. Why? Because applying the transformation once produces a multiple times the same thing. And then applying it again multiplies that squares the multiple and once again produces the same thing. So it's that multiple squared times the same thing. So e to the px is still very much, and that's what you're seeing here, e to the px is very much still an eigenvector, eigenfunction, and the corresponding eigenvalue is p squared. Very interesting. So once again, still infinitely many eigenvalues, but now this only gives us positive numbers. And to every positive value, such as 25, there are two corresponding eigenfunctions. So that the eigenspace corresponding to that eigenvalue is two-dimensional. It's e to the 5x and e to the minus 5x. Both will produce the same eigenvalue of 25. So very interesting. Still infinitely many eigenvalues, but now they're only positive numbers. And the corresponding eigenspaces are two-dimensional, whereas in this case, the corresponding eigenspaces were one-dimensional. Very interesting. Kind of similar to this. Preserve the eigenvalue, but now the eigenspace is two-dimensional. It seems like the dimensionality of all the eigenspaces corresponds to the order of the derivative. All right, but of course there is one more, and you can kind of see the clue right here. Well, maybe two more, sines and cosines. We would have to think very carefully about the dimensionality of the corresponding eigenspaces because sines and cosines mix in a very nice way according to the trigonometric formulas. But we can basically, since I'm out of space, I'll just transform this formula. Second derivative of sine of px, and the same thing for cosine, is minus p squared, right? So make sure that that holds for both sine and cosine. When you take the derivative of sine, it becomes cosine, and then take the derivative of cosine, that's where you pick up the minus sign. And with cosine, the derivative of cosine is minus sine, and then derivative of minus sine is cosine. So it's on the first step that you pick up the minus sign. Equals minus p squared sine of px, or minus p squared cosine of px. So sine and cosine work very similarly. So that's where the negative numbers as eigenvalues come from. So there's eigenvalues associated with these transformations are all the negative numbers. Very interesting. So exponents give us all the positive numbers. Sines and cosines give us all the negative numbers. And I'll just leave it up to you to work with a little bit of calculus and a little bit of trigonometry to show that the dimension of the corresponding eigenspace is 2 in this case as well. You'll need to do a little bit of trigonometry. You have to modify a linear combination of a sine and a cosine into a single sine or cosine. I think you'll be able to do it, that's just a hint, but there you go. I think this completes this example, and we have now encountered the exact same concepts in a completely different vector space, the space of polynomials and functions, but we were still able to talk about transformations, their linearity, and their associated eigenvalues and eigenvectors.